Thank you for the invitation. Hi, everyone. So today I'm the honor to start the meeting. So it's a pleasure to be with all of you. I'm going to guide you through the discovery process or in pharmacology we follow within domain therapeutics regarding G-protein kappa receptors, a family of well-known membrane proteins. And I will provide you some information regarding pathways that we are following to discover innovative drug, and some concrete examples on the validation of such pathways for well-known targets, but also collaboration that we have with big pharma like Pfizer. So just briefly for G-protein kappa receptors, there are more than 350 different therapeutic GPCRs. They are quite famous. They are membrane receptors. More than 100 GPCRs are currently exploited, and roughly 900 billions of total revenues in the recent years. And it represents roughly one third of approved drugs. So we do work on those targets within domain, but we also are working on quite challenging other GPCR targets, like CNS targets from the mGluR family. We recently announced this morning a positive collaboration with Merck in immune oncology on A2A receptors, so in immunosuppressive receptors. We have also other programs in pain. And we also have collaboration on the orphan GPCRs with Boehringer Ingelheim, especially in the discovery of surrogate ligand for CNS targets. And currently, our target of interest covers three disease areas, so the rare disease, onco-immuno-onc, and CNS disorder. But to find the appropriate drugs for such target, of course, we would like to discover and characterize very well the pharmacology. And for that, we and characterize the full G-alpha family of proteins. So from the four families, GQ, GS, GI, and G12, G13. And we have other biosensors to follow beta-arrestin recruitment and others that are more second messengers and distal effectors. And we have also developed some biosensors to follow the trafficking of membrane protein, plasma membrane protein to the endosome and later on to the lysosome. All those biosensors allow us to follow those events in real time. There's no lysis step. This is an example of how it is developed. It's based on the bioluminescence resonance energy transfer, so BRET technology. The principle is that we have one protein infusion with GFP and one other protein infusion with RNA luciferase. And in fact, what we do follow is protein-protein interaction. And when we'll have a proximity between the GFP and the luciferase, we will have a BRET signal. So we can follow those events in real time, meaning recruitment and separation. So this allows us, for example, to study G-protein recruitment. It's a way to study beta-arrestin recruitment. It's a way also to study when we put the two sensors on the same protein to follow change of conformation. It's what, for example, we did for PKC or cyclic AMP. And all those events can be followed in 384 well-plate format and are amenable for HTS. Recently, it's a paper submitted to Cell that was put for free on BioArchive already last week. It's a way for us to study several GPCRs. It's a paper where we studied the signaling pathways upon activation of 100 different GPCRs. We also do such a work in collaboration with Pfizer and US. So here are examples of the sensors that we have developed in terms of G-protein recruitment, beta-arrestin recruitment in this case, but also some effector proteins. And those are, I'm not going to go in details, but just to show you that we were able to follow 12 different pathways, and those are spider representation. When you have a color, it means that you have activation of the pathway. When it's white, there's no activation. And so you can see that from the 100 GPCRs, you have several GPCRs that activate only one family of pathways, or two families, three families, or the four G alpha families. And we can represent that with heat map representations where we can follow the Emacs, the efficacy of the activation of such pathways with a ligand, but also the potency in terms of PEC50s. And here is a representation and on how is distributed the coupling, specific double coupling, triple coupling, or four couplings together. Here are the number of GPCR that couple to one, two, three, or four of those pathways. And here are a broader view of the number of G-alpha proteins that are recognized by the full family of GPCRs. So based on that, we decided to combine two biosensors that recapitulate most of those signaling pathways, a combination between GZ and G15. And when we use such a biosensors and we apply to a family of GPCRs, we tested different ligands. And what you can see in green are the match that were expected to be detected, meaning the natural ligands like noradrenaline that can activate the alpha adrenergic receptors and the beta adrenergic receptors is quite well known. What you have in yellow are activation that were not expected to be detected. Here are for data we generate that show that we have a cis activation of the receptor, meaning that for example, for the D2 receptor, when we activate with dopamine, it's expected to have a very nice dose response. What is interesting is when you look at other ligands like noradrenaline, we also observe a response, and this response can be abolished by a specific D2 antagonist. So it's a way to see that we have a direct activation of the receptor by ligand that were not really described for such a ligand, for such a receptor. This another example for CB1 is quite different. Here in this case is it's not a cis but it's a trans activation. It means that two ligand can activate the receptor, but only one antagonist or antagonist that is specific for the dedicated receptor can block it. And our speculation is something that we will follow is that there's a production of the through activation of one receptor, there's a production of a ligand that will activate another one. It's why we call it a trans activation. So based on those biosensors that we can dissect the pharmacology, we also wanted to study more deeply other family of the GPCR cluster, and we have performed some work on opioids. Everyone is aware of the opioid crisis. So we have performed some study on the mu opioid receptor, and we have followed different pathways. What is interesting is that beta-arrestin 2 pathway is suspected to be involved in constipation and some depression, respiratory depression. And it was a huge effort from the pharma industry and biotech to try to develop drugs that will be biased for one pathway versus the other. So what we was performed is that different non-opioids were tested on this receptor. And from a screening performed by Pfizer, 15 novel compounds identified through the screening were also performed in terms of, or evaluated in terms of signaling pathway in comparison to the 10 non-opioids. Here are the data. So here you have the reference 10 opioids in different signaling pathways and in a concentration response curve manner. Here are the new 15 compounds from Pfizer screening. And you can see that we can cluster those compounds based on the response. And we can determine three types of response, cluster one, cluster two, and cluster three. And you have some compounds that are associated to already known opioid endogenous ligand, but also different types of response. And we can, from that, focus on pathways and compounds that will trigger expected response in terms of pharmacology and not based on the structure. So here are the correlation between the side effect and the response. We look at the log of tau and Emax, or log to Emax and log to tau versus Ka. No reason to go in details, but just to show you that based on such a study, we can really correlate the side effect to the response and to focus on compounds that will be with a less side effect. Here it's what we obtain on recombinant system. Of course, it's always important to have a translation from recombinant to real pharmacology on cells. Here are data regarding knocking mouse. So those mouse were modified to express the opioid receptor, but also the venous tag. And we were able to perform some studies on neurons from those animals and to confirm what we have obtained in terms of response on recurrent system to what we obtain also on primary cells on neurons from those mice, and to have a very nice correlation between the recurrent system and the primary system, to see that we have a nice correlation from recurrent to primary cells. So this is a translation, the discovery and the translation from the lab to the animal. It's also good always to look at what's happening in patients and to go from patients to study new programs. Here is just a reminder that there was a nice publication in Cell in 2018 where people look at more than 100 GPCRs and from more than 60,000 patients, and they look at more than 14,000 mutations, and they characterize those mutations in terms of ligand binding, effector coupling, transduction, basal activity, and to see the impact potentially of those mutations in terms of physiological response, but also the response to drugs. So there's a huge initiative in UK with the UK Biobank from pharma industry, where they decided to sequence the genome of the exome of more than 500,000 volunteers. And those volunteers have been characterized in terms of some behavior, but also we have access to some biological fluids, some data in terms of blood pressure, and so on. So we decided to collaborate with Pfizer using our biosensors platform, and to characterize 50 GPCRs from different family, and to characterize up to 50 different SNPs or mutations occurring in this population. And the objective is to study and associate some mutations with phenotype. Here are examples of data. There are three examples. So here is a schematic representation of a GPCR with seven transmembrane domain. And in colors, you have the different amino acids that have some mutations. So in green, you have a mutation that will trigger a pharmacology that is similar to the wild type. In red, you have the mutations that will induce a full loss of function for four pathways. So we look at GS, G15, GZ, and beta arrestin, for example. And you have 15 variants for which that trigger a full loss of functions. And we have other variants, 16 in this case, that will induce a partial loss of function or a bias in terms of response. And this allows us to associate some of those mutations with a dedicated pharmacology to a clinical phenotype. What is the beauty is that instead of to consider each mutant as an individual one, we can cluster them based on the similar pharmacological function, and then to be able to have some p-values that are really of interest and make a nice correlation between the genotype and the phenotype. This is another example where we have four types of clusters. Again, green in wild type response. In red, we have a full loss of function. In yellow, we have a partial loss of functions. Here is is interesting. We have a full list of functions for some pathways, and we have even a switch of function. For example, here you see that for one mutant in the wild type, we have for the wild type, you have an increase of the signaling pathway, whereas for the mutants, we have an inverse response, so meaning that we have a decrease of the pathway. So it's really a switch from activation to inhibition for this mutant. And here is another example with a partial loss of function across multiple pathways that are also linked to some disease. For example, we were also able to characterize some mutants on MC4 and demonstrate that those mutants are really linked to early onset obesity, for example. So just to recapitulate the presentation, so we have developed a large number of breadth biosensors that allow us to study more than 15 different signaling pathways. Those biosensors, the advantage is that they are we can use them in real time without any lysis of the cells, so we can really follow the kinetics and do not have a bias in the interpretation, because we would have to stop the system, and we were able to determine the coupling of more than 100 GPCRs for 12 heterotumeric G proteins and beta arrestin. We were able to demonstrate that there are significant heterogeneity and diversity in the coupling for those GPCRs. Two biosensors, when they are associated, can recapitulate most of the signaling pathways, and we decided to use them for the safety and tox profiling of GPCRs, what I have presenting, and to discover new pharmacology, new ligand for well-known GPCRs with strong sources activation. Just to give you an information, for example, when we look at the analysis of the mutants that we perform with Pfizer, roughly 60, two-thirds of the tested mutants showed a change in the function in terms of GPCR's activation. It can be loss of function, gain of function, can be biased, but it's really huge. We were able to confirm that those mutations are linked to a known phenotype, like what I said for MC4 for early onset obesity, but we were also able to discover a new variant, new GPCRs or GPCRs with mutation, and to link that to disease. It can be cardiovascular, it can be metabolic disorders. It's really a huge information, and we will continue with Pfizer in the next 2 years to characterize new variants, new GPCRs in such initiative. And we have applied that. It's more for the patients to discovery and to characterize target, but we also apply such platform in our daily work when we perform HTS and we go from hit to lead and lead optimization, and we have applied that for our huge collaboration with Boehringer Ingelheim for CNS GPCRs, but also with Merck in immuno-oncology and for GPCRs that are involved in immunosuppression in the tumor microenvironment. And from that, I would like to thank you and to conclude my speech now.